Forum mondial de l'économie responsable est né en 2007 dans le nord de la France. Son but est de faire connaître les...
The Economic World Forum was born in the north of France, aiming at promoting companies that work in the field of corporate social responsibility. Since 2007, we've been addressing different dimensions of a responsible economy. Various topics are addressed. Responsible economy has many aspects. For various days, corporate managers, local authorities, non-profit organizations, and students take part in participative workshops. More than 5,000 participants each year. Hundreds of participants from different nationalities present their vision of the economy and share their experience. And this is what makes the success of each of our conference. The Alliance Network has set up this event. Being a pioneer of responsible economy in the north of France, it has established networks with Global Compact, with the Global Reporting Initiative from CSR Europe. Beyond each conference, the Lille World Forum makes toolboxes available in order for everyone to consult and spread the good word. This is the case for the BPIS, the international platform for good corporate social responsibility practices. We are supported by Salis Hub. We're supporting the third industrial revolution. This is why the World Forum is the forum for all players in responsible economy. So join us and start being provocative and in favor of a responsible economy. So be active and proactive in social responsibility. We met with lots of proactive players in those five cities that we visited. We'll tell you about this week during the morning. But right now, I'd like to ask Jean-Paul Vermes, the chairperson of the Chamber of Commerce of Paris, to welcome us. Thank you, Mr. Chair. Dear Philippe Vasseur, Chair of the World Forum, dear colleague, Mr. Governor of the French Bank, ladies and gentlemen, directors, dear friends. It is a pleasure for me to host you in this Chamber of Commerce for the Île-de-France region. It's a pleasure and an honor to host the final closing conference of the Lille World Forum for Responsible Economy after a rich and fruitful week which took you in many different cities in France. You came here to debate about the role of companies in society. And this is the House of Companies, so this is where you need to be. It's a beautiful objective that Alliance defined to support companies so that they can improve their performance whilst improving society, societal environment, and the environment. I'd like to congratulate Philippe Vasseur for being at the origin of this World Forum, the success of which has been increasing over the years. There are many participants and speakers are very prestigious speakers. So that's a beautiful initiative, and of course we want to support it. As you know, our mission is to serve companies, to support them in their development projects. At the moment, development fits within a highly competitive environment at global level. We know that companies need to demonstrate their attractiveness and competence in order to face global evolution of markets. Companies need to be able to adapt to the different changes in the different industries. For companies to remain viable and innovative and support energy consumption, and for them to be societally healthy. It's a true challenge, and as any challenge, it's a good source of opportunity that need to be captured and anticipated. And this is where the Chamber of Commerce intervenes to help carry out certain projects, whether we're talking about digital transformation, sustainable development, or corporate social responsibility. For instance, we had this cooperation with Paris Region Enterprise, with the Chamber of Commerce of Essonne and the City of Paris. We implemented a collective action for corporate social responsibility in the Paris region to support SMEs understand better what CSR is about and help them implement CSR. It's also in the same and with the same ambition that we signed with the transportation companies within Paris that we implemented a CSR charter. Greater Paris wants to set the example in terms of job creation and participation of SMEs. So this is going to be a very fruitful morning, the achievement of an intense morning. A new world is coming up, and we need to play our role in this new world. It's your responsibility, it's our responsibility to pave the way for future economy. And the Chamber of Commerce of Paris will do everything it can to support you along with the 650,000 companies in our region. So have a very nice morning. Be happy. It's going to be a beautiful moment for you and for all of us. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I like it when you say, be happy. So this week is a high point, but all week long with the work, it's a high point for us in the Alliance network. So this is going to be a summary or a conclusion moment. And it's important so that we can learn the lessons of everything we heard this week to try and meet provide a response to the question, companies, what for? Philippe Vasseur, over to you. Well, what's fine is that Jean-Paul Vermes allows me to shorten my speech because he said many of the things that I wanted to say, and he concluded his speech by saying, be happy. And that's one of the topics that we developed yesterday in La Rochelle when we talked about happiness in the workplace. And this is where we can demonstrate there is narrow cooperation between the well-being of employees and the performance of a company, which is our objective. Our objective is to demonstrate that, because of course, corporate manager needs to improve its economic performance, but we can do that whilst paying more respect to people, to the environment, and take into account the interests of all stakeholders. And to achieve that, we don't use big speeches. We use good practices, and we share good practices from different companies in order to demonstrate what's feasible. Our originality, as we're not enslaved to any organization, is that we have no taboos. We have partners that accept we work without any taboos, and we challenge issues which can be controversial issues. And that was the case on Monday in Lille, because Antoine Frérot, CEO of Veolia, made an inspiring speech in which he said, hold on, wait for it, that a company is a common good entity. So we had kind of violent reactions from distinguished economists, and economists are always distinguished people, who said that according to Milton Friedman, companies, the corporate social responsibility, was to make profit for their shareholders. And Friedman was awarded the Nobel Prize of Economy. I think today the Nobel Prize of Economy is awarded in different conditions. So there is a debate that consists in saying, well, at the end of the day, Is are companies useful because they're performant, or are they performant because they're useful? In the Friedman version, a company is useful because it's profitable. The objective of a company is to make profit for shareholders. And by the way, I have nothing against shareholders. They need to make profit. But then you have other questions. And what Antoine Frérot says is, well, no, it's profitable when it's useful. So now you have 4 hours. You can write a dissertation on this topic. No, I'm kidding. But it's a beautiful topic on which we can reflect. And we need to agree on the word useful. A company is necessarily useful, otherwise it can't exist. It's useful because it meets a requirement or a need. I could tell you about, or some companies meet the needs of clients. You have companies working in the world of what's superfluous, and it's fine, but usefulness is relative. And when Antoine Frérot, and I'll stop talking about Antoine Frérot because he said many other very interesting and shocking things. For instance, he said that he was in favor of having, sitting on the board, you'd have shareholders, employee representatives, that's mandatory by law, but he also wanted to have representatives of the territories where his company was operating and representatives from his clients. So that's going to be food for thought for the coming years. But to him, usefulness had to be understood in its exhaustive meaning. A company is there to meet the requirements of its clients, of its shareholders, but it also has another role in society. So you can have Friedman's version, but quite clearly, over the last few years, a lot has been expected from companies. And the more we feel that political powers have difficulties meeting the needs of society, the more we turn towards other players like companies. So the question is, companies, what for? There are limits. You can't ask everything to companies, but we can't eliminate all limits. So that was a question that we wanted to raise this year. And of course, in the backdrop, we had the idea of responsibility. What should companies do? This is a question that we raised all along this week. We are currently completing a marathon, because before we came here in Paris, we were in Lille, then in Strasbourg, in Grenoble, in La Rochelle, so every day in a different city, to have a multi-site forum, which is possible thanks to new technologies. And we did that because this year is our 10th anniversary. Listen to this, 10th anniversary. It gives us seniority. 10 years ago, we were not talking about CSR as we do today. Lots of things happened over the last 10 years. Many, many things, many, many changes. 10 years back, when you were talking to a panel of business managers, when you were talking about 3D printing, when you were saying that in the near future we'd have driver-free cars, they would look at you thinking you were crazy or that you enjoyed reading sci-fi. But we know that these are hard facts today. Sometimes we find it difficult to anticipate on what's going to happen. 10 years ago, we would hardly mention that, and today we're right in the middle of it. And 10 years back, Uber was not in existence. It was created in 2009, and we've seen all the changes it brought about. 10 years back, Lehman Brothers. Who would have thought 10 years back, that's in 27 or 2006, who would have thought that Lehman Brothers would go under? No one. So it shows how fragile our institutions are. When you know that 70% of the top 1,000 companies that were listed in the US no longer exist at the moment, you realize that this is a fast-changing world, that there are mutations being operated, that we are entering a new economic world or a new economic system, we hope we will adapt and we will move towards greater responsibility. And I think it all depends on us. We have this desire. If we came here, it's because we've got this on our mind. Also, can public authorities? We're not asking public authorities to do things on behalf of companies, but we may ask them to better understand what's going on in the world of corporation. And I'm afraid that in the month to come, this is not going to be an in-depth debate, whereas we should. I have some ideas, like a positive tax system. I know that tax system needs to be neutral and should not be in favor of such or such group of individuals. But we have a punitive tax system at the moment. For instance, we have this quota system for companies, but if you don't go by the quota system for disabled people, all you do is pay a fine. I'd rather go for giving tax credits to those companies who take positive action in that respect. I'd rather encourage positive discrimination rather than punitive discrimination. And this might sound shocking to some of you, but introducing environmental, social responsibility clauses in public markets would help us have a virtuous economy and would encourage local corporations. And these were just a few examples, but I think this deserves to be thought about by our politicians, whether at national level or at local level. Okay, so we are on this journey. 10 years back, we had the feeling that we were preaching to the desert, but at the moment, we believe that we are preaching to the choir, and it's an increasingly big choir, realizing that environmental and societal issues are important for this world. I'd like to conclude on a McKinsey study that says that 36% of CEOs and corporate managers see CSR as one of their three priorities for their business. And I'm talking about business, not, we're not talking about philanthropy. And even 13% of them, not 13 of the 36, 13% of all CEOs that list this concern as their top priority. I think it's huge. Some of you might argue it's a very small percentage, but I think it's quite a lot. It's our responsibility to make this figure increase. And I think all the testimony we are going to listen to this morning will make it possible for us to move forward so that we can all contribute to the rising of a more responsible economy. And I think that's the prerequisite if we want those systems that we want to protect today, if we want them to be sustainable. And I'm saying we might be the saviors of capitalism, because I think that without responsibility, society as we know it today is under threat. So thank you for attending this conference. Thank you for being a member of this movement. And your presence is an encouragement for us to continue this movement for another 10 years. And we'll celebrate our 20th anniversary with you. Well, thank you very much indeed, Philip. This World Forum has two virtues. The first one is that it offers you and all networks working with you, it allows them to share good practices. That's part of the World Forum DNA. And, you know, listening to good practices, an example, is probably a very good motivation to take action. And if you look at the McKinsey indicator that was shared with you by Philippe Vasseur just a minute ago, it's because all these action proposals, inspiring actions, all these projects turned CSR into a strategic lever for companies. And we are now going to listen to different speakers, and we'll certainly hear contributions. Of course, we've worked with them to collect good practices, and then we will disseminate these good practices to all companies. So let me introduce Roman and Valentine. What's their job? They have a computer. Roman is in charge of moderating our debates on social networks. He's been doing that since the beginning of this week with the hashtag shown at the shown on the slide. And something happened because digital communication, you know, we know exactly which are our targets and how messages are sent out. So how many messages did we get? Well, we have more than 3 million Twitter accounts that received a Twitter with WFRE16. Yeah, it's 3,160,632 tweets. So it means that the World Forum trademark has reached out to more than 3 million people. And you are information catalysts, so feel free to send out the message, and you have the tweet feed that will be displayed on the screen all along the morning. As to Valentine uses her favorite search engine, and we ask her to be on the internet at all time, and we ask her to be on the lookout for information using keywords pronounced by our speakers. So this morning is going to be very dense and very fruitful, like the 4 days that we spent throughout France. We talked about major issues. Philip was talking about employees' well-being. That's a topic we addressed in La Rochelle. We talked about artificial intelligence, we talked about collaborative intelligence, we talked about social business, we had workshops, plenary sessions, and many other high points during these days. More than 150 speakers, by the way. And as we did in other cities, let's take a look at a short summary of what happened yesterday in La Rochelle. So 10th anniversary. Companies, what for? 5 days to get mobilized.
Bonjour Paris et welcome.
Welcome on board this 10th World Forum for Responsible Economy, day 4 here in La Rochelle. Like a skipper, a company manager needs to find the best crew, but being demanding does not prevent CEOs to pay attention to his or her stakeholders, otherwise the company goes under. Because there are interdependencies, healthy interdependencies with these stakeholders in order to fare a safe journey. So welcome. Verifying a positive impact on society is difficult to measure, but it's still possible when each indicator is green-lighted. To achieve that, a committed entrepreneur needs to make sure that information is well communicated.
And he's trying to keep them on board, so trying to give them as much information as possible to help and support them, not just talk to them, but to give them the tools to show how they can be corporate responsible.
Être co-responsable.
Being co-responsible means sharing sustainable objectives where the contribution of one is going to raise awareness in others. The first thing that a company needs to do is to present your vision of things, how you see the future. And then you can share this vision with all stakeholders. So it means you need to be transparent. You need to be transparent in the way you manage a company. You want to show the way, going further, adapting to the rhythm of each individual and to their culture when they're at the other end of the planet. Well, we need to work together on the long term. We need to work about transparency in order to share successes and difficulties and make mutual efforts, choosing, selecting the good journey to ensure well-being of employees and federate the positive energies in order to always have pleasure working together. Okay, many keywords emerging from these exchanges. You heard the word vision, you heard the word common interest. We also talked a lot about territories during the week, and it's in territories that these new economies, these new networks are being developed. And we were talking about experience feedback, which were very important. And there is this prefix, which is very important, which is co or joint. Joint working, co-inventing. That's very important. So this morning, it's our pleasure to have committed speakers, speakers who are involved or committed, engaged in territories, in companies, so that they share their vision to try and answer this question. Companies, what for? And come up with concrete proposals, because companies are on their on the track. So, Mr. Governor of the Banque de France, Mr. Villeroy de Gallo, welcome. The Banque de France, Bank of France, started working on sustainable development 8 to 10 years ago, and they deployed eco-responsible actions. And at the moment, François Villeroy de Gallo comes to tell us that for those companies that they are listing and supporting, Banque de France, Bank of France, is going to focus on corporate social responsibility. And that is very important, because many CEOs who've been working with us in the World Forum since the beginning of this week, they ask us this question: give me visibility so that I can work with CSR indicators and KPIs. So welcome, sir.
Bonjour à vous tous. People, but I will speak in French, which is more comfortable for me. Bonjour aux deux présidents qui nous accueillent.
Good morning to both chairmen, including Philip Vasseur. First of all, please allow me to congratulate you for this World Forum. Congratulations, because you went to beautiful places. We just saw the video, which was shot in La Rochelle. You went to Lille, one of the most beautiful cities of France, and you are completing the event right here in Paris. What a beautiful city and what a beautiful venue. I would like to congratulate you also for your 10th anniversary. I think you've come to the age of respectability. I'm speaking in the name of an even older organization. In 2016, we're celebrating our 216th birthday or anniversary. So you may be wondering what the Banque de France is doing and has been doing since the euro was introduced. Well, we have three big missions, the three S's: monetary strategy, financial stability, with monitoring of banks and financial institutions, and economic services, which is the third S. This morning, I would like to add another S: social. At the Banque de France, we have decided to strongly insist on our social commitment, CSR as such. And I would like to give you some concrete examples of what we have accomplished. I'll give you two concrete examples. In-house, within the company, we've made CSR one of the tangible objectives of the bank. And this is a way for us to become more responsible, socially responsible. And we've become more active outside of the bank. The third S is serving the economy. And we've decided there again to reinforce CSR with the companies we rate. And we've taken a very innovative approach of this. Let me say a few words about CSR as being part of our corporate strategy. Banque de France has for years had a CSR policy with different actions, sustainable development actions, for example, actions to reduce our footprint. We've had different sponsorships as well and economic support measures. But as many public institutions, the Banque de France did a lot of things without really communicating about it. Because we just take a lot of things for granted in a sense. And we've decided in the framework of our new 2020 plan to reaffirm our CSR policy with clear objectives and in a very ambitious and demanding way. The objectives are directly connected to decisions made by the Banque de France board. I would like to share with you two of my convictions. CSR can only be something serious and credible if you have two things. First of all, you need readability. In order to be motivating for employees. Second, you need to be professional. You need professionalism, as much professionalism as with everything else you do. If you are meeting these two requirements, well then, there is no suspicion that it's just social washing or public relations. So our objective at CSR has four concrete objectives: education, culture, citizens, environmental objectives, and our employees. So these four commitments have translated in 11 priority actions. Each action has a high-level sponsor who is clearly identified, and each action comes with a number of indicators, strict, demanding, ambitious indicators. Thanks to this, we were able to identify that there were a number of areas where there was room for progress. And I would like to give you just one example. Support to microcredits. We have decided to support and promote microcredits. We have been awarding two awards since 2013 for exemplary microcredit examples, but we've also been monitoring the growth of microcredits in France. The latest figure is 1.2 billion of outstandings at the end of 2015, which is still fairly small compared to the overall amount of outstandings in the economy. However, this figure is up in a spectacular fashion compared to the previous year, up 8%. So with a new CSR policy, we have decided to reinforce what we already had, but also launch a number of additional initiatives. Let me give you two of these. First of all, the Banque de France recently became the operator for the National Economic and Financial Education program. You may not be familiar with this program. Let me tell you what it is. Well, concretely, Banque de France will be working with all stakeholders active in this area. So non-for-profits, public services, the French national education, social workers as well, in order to disseminate knowledge on personal finance and at a more general level, knowledge about the economy. This has obviously a social impact, especially for the underprivileged, to learn, teach them how to better manage their budget. There is a democratic objective as well, a civic objective, because this is a key component in today's society. It is a complex topic, and we want to make sure everyone has the means and resources, that people are properly informed about what is going on. We believe that this will make a difference. It's a way to renew the democracy and a citizen debate in our country. So we're obviously reaching out to a very broad audience, younger people, students, teachers, and once again, those who are more fragile and, more generally speaking, all citizens, really. And once again, for the underprivileged, we're also trying to provide preventive measures. Once again, households who are excessive debt, for example. And last year, and I must say I'm quite proud of this, we have provided support to 237,000 families who had excessive debt. The second initiative is to provide additional support to very small organizations, very small companies. And we have a correspondent, a contact person now who is dedicated to that, who is there to provide support to very small companies and help them with their finances and help them engage in better relationships with banks as well. This is now up and running and has been effective since September the 30th. And I said we also had a pilot. We have a pilot with the outside world, which is to work more and in a better way with companies we list. You may not all be familiar with what we do, and this may, for some of you, be a bit of a surprise and maybe even a paradox, because spontaneously, intrinsically, it's not the role of a central bank to look into what companies do in terms of CSR. CSR has to do with your own strategy, not necessarily the strategy of others. But we consider at the Banque de France that we have a responsibility, because we rate companies. We measure French companies' capabilities to honor their financial commitments for the next 3 years. And when we rate the companies, we provide banks, for example, with information they need to make better decisions. We also allow business leaders to position themselves on a risk scale, and we facilitate a dialogue between the two. So by listing companies, we can diversify funding sources for companies. This is absolutely essential, especially for SMEs. And we try to go beyond credit organizations. They play a key role, no need to say. And but insurance companies as well, funds, crowdfunding platforms, the local collectivities, and so on. So by rating companies, you get more diversity in funding, the funding of the third industrial revolution, which is dear to you, Mr. Chairman. So the listing we do, or the rating, rather, we do, has to reflect the resilience of companies that are rated. And therefore, as a pilot, we have decided to now to add to the existing financial criteria CSR criteria. And this is something which other central banks have never done before. So let me be clear, we're not rating companies' CSR policies. However, our objective is to analyze the commitment between the commitment of companies in terms of CSR and their financial resilience. We are all convinced that companies that have a robust CSR policy can be more sustainable. And likewise, when your CSR policy is less ambitious, you might be less resilient. And it impacts everything. It impacts wages, it impacts happiness at work, employee well-being, and it even impacts the relationships between companies and their suppliers. And there are different economic studies that suggest there is a really interest in the connection between CSR and company performance. A study that was carried out in 2013 showed there is a significant connection between CSR efforts and economic performance. The correlation shows plus 13%. Better CSR means better economic performance. Better, 13% better. So, what are we seeing in practice? Well, the pilot we have launched is based on two pillars. The Banque de France analysis is now based on specific CSR information with its three components, of course, social, society, and environmental. And we are doing this nationwide. Initially, we started in 2012 in the Région de Loire, and we've now extended it to the entire country. In addition to this, we have CSR interviews. These are face-to-face interviews that are carried out by our analysts and these companies, and we have a very up-to-date database. So far, 10,000 companies have been or will be interviewed on their CSR policy. This is very important because this, in a sense, sets the stage. It allows us to better gauge companies' resilience. So this is ongoing in 2017, and in the meantime, we're keeping an ongoing dialogue as well with the CSR stakeholders. So this is what I wanted to share with you. Again, one initiative within the company, another initiative carried out by Banque de France outside of the company. I would like to come back for a moment to the name of this conference, a responsible economy. It's interesting that these two words should be together because for years they were in opposition. On the one hand, we had once again two very opposed terms, and I probably, like you, believe in both. I believe in convergence between the two. I was fortunate enough to meet a lot of business leaders in my life, and without them, nothing would be possible. And I today work for a public institution serving society. I've explained today what we are doing at Banque de France. And in summary, what I can say is that at Banque de France, we believe in CSR and we want to be active in CSR. Thank you.
Merci, Monsieur le Gouverneur. Vous restez.
Thank you, Mr. Governor. Please stay with us. I would like to ask Simon Zedek to join us now. Please, Simon. And welcome to you. Please, have a seat. So, Simon Zedek is a co-director of the United Nations Environment Program. They have great experience. They've worked on different environmental programs and the financing of environmental programs. We'll come back to some of Simon's current missions at UNEP. The reason why I've asked him to join us now is because I'd like him to react, maybe if he wants to, about your vision on CSR in your organization. We've just had a good flavor of what you do, and you insisted on the importance of bringing meaning, making it meaningful. You wanted to be something that's shared by all employees, and you insisted on the professionalism as well. And this is certainly something we talked about. At the beginning, when we talked about CSR in the early days, we said, well, you want to do CSR, why don't you hire an intern? Things have changed, dramatically changed, and that's good. Things have professionalized. And you talked about CSR and performance, company performance, resilience as well. So I'm very much looking forward to the results of your early results. There are some interesting pre-results, indicators so that are suggesting some strong connections between active CSR and company performance and resilience. So on these specific points, Mr. Zadek, actually I'd like to come back also to the education. Well, but at this point, Mr. Zadek, do you have any comments on these two points or any questions maybe for the governor?
I'll speak in English. I find that easier. So actually, governor, I'd like to start off by congratulating you. I think the rendition of what the Bank of France has done and is planning to do is exemplary. And perhaps just to locate that comment, you might think of central banks in the world today going through four different phases. Yeah, there are many central banks that would start off by saying corporate responsibility, environmental issues, broader societal issues are simply not our concern, not our job, not our mandate. We're not policymakers, we're not policy implementers, we're regulators. And I would say the list of central banks in that area is long, very long. Mm-hmm. I think then there is a second group that would argue that the classical mandate, monetary stability, financial stability, perhaps banking regulation, means sustainable development and corporate responsibility. You know, if we get our core mandate right, then we are contributing to society. That's the deal. That's sort of level two, if you like. But I feel that the Bank of France is moving into what I would see as level three and level four. You're building on your classical mandate and adding in a number of other elements, and that is exemplary. I think the whole points about financial inclusion, SMEs, education, all speaks to that broader perspective as to what central banking can be and should be. But I think it goes beyond that. I think what you're arguing is for the fourth level, which is a more integrated approach. Mm-hmm. That it's possible to understand financial stability as something that needs to take account of environmental issues and needs to take account of social issues. It's important to understand good conduct assessment within the market from the perspective of the way board directors look at broader social and environmental issues in their decisions. That it seems to me, sir, that you're pushing the agenda of central banks through to that third and fourth higher level. My question to you, if I may, is to really ask you about your colleagues in other central banks. You are a member of the Financial Stability Board, the Bank of International Settlements. You're involved in the IMF and other critical institutions and forums where global central banking rules and practice and norms are set. What role can you take, or are you taking, in advancing your perspective on the future of central banking in those venues?
Bon. Vous commentez, puis après j'aurai une... Alors vous lui répondez, hein, et j'aurai une question aussi à vous.
Well, first of all, thank you, Simon, for... I like the four levels, and thank you for putting us in the third or fourth. I think I'd like to answer to your question in two parts. First of all, I think it is important to build consistency between these different levels, especially starting at the second level. At the first level, there is no CSR, so there is not much to be said. But the second level is crucial. As you said, the core mission of a central bank is monetary policies, financial stability, and so on. And no fear, there should be no fear. Don't worry. I will still say the same thing: why the ECB policy is right and why we manage the, you know, stability in France the way we do it. But when you do that, or while you do that, we also contribute to a more responsible economy. And if you don't, I think you're missing the very core of your social responsibility. CSR can only be credible if it's done in a professional way. And it has to be consistent with the core missions of your company. If the core missions of your company are not to serve society, then it's not CSR. If you just do CSR to look good, then it doesn't work. You have to really socially contribute. And that has to be one of the core values of the company. And I think this is what Philippe Vasseur was saying earlier. Do you perform well because you're useful, or are you useful because you perform well? So yes, level two is crucial, as I said. So coming back to the community of central banks, I think we've done a fair amount of work. I think what we do different is the rating of companies. That's definitely a best practice. But let me give you two examples of things we've talked about time and again. Financial inclusion. That's one topic. And this may be a surprise. When central banks meet in Basel and other places, it's a recurring topic, believe it or not. And this is certainly the case with colleagues working or coming from emerging economies, but not only, also in advanced economies. And there are ongoing initiatives. Ren Maxima from the Netherlands, you were probably not expecting her name, but she's a UN ambassador on this specific topic, and we've been working very actively with her. And another example is climate change, which I have not mentioned. So, of course, central banks are not going to put an end to climate change. The financial sector can't do it, but we have a role to play. We have a responsibility. We have to understand the long-term impacts and risks of climate change. I've talked about this. Mark Harnay, the Canadian who's managing the Bank of England, has also talked about this a number of times. And there is interesting ongoing research on information that should be published about carbon risks, climate risks. And we're also developing stress tests. So just to come back to your question and what we're doing, well, I think we're doing a number of things. And I think we have good reasons to be optimistic. I have a question about your pilot. What are the kind of questions you're asking companies to actually rate or assess their CSR initiatives? Well, we have quantitative questions. Typically, we start with a very simple question, which may be a bit of a surprise. First question is, do you have a CSR policy, period, or question mark, rather. And then, of course, we go a bit further and we actually analyze exactly what they do, how their CSR policy is articulated. Our objective was not, of course, to list or rate. It's not like we're not a rating agency. Rating agencies do a different job. We do not want it to be a burden for companies. But it's something we have to assess this also during the pilot. If we really want to be legitimate, we have to show the added value. We don't want to be this a burden, so we have to do something which is balanced. We have to do it in a serious way, but we have to keep simple as well. So once again, the first question, and this may sound very basic, but it's important. Some companies are big, some companies are very small. So the first question is, do you have a CSR policy? And once again, the next questions are aimed at better understanding what it is.
Question on my side. So you mentioned the Dutch. The Dutch central bank, the DNB, is one of the first central banks in the OECD to adopt sustainable development as an overarching policy objective. So it's now incorporated into their mandate rather than a distinct track of work. And every part of DNB is now required to work out, if you like, what the implications of this broader mandate is for their activities. The Swedish Central Bank has recently pursued the same path, although through legislation, and the People's Bank of China has done the same. At the moment, it's still very unusual, and my question, I think, Governor, is whether you feel now would be a good time to advance at the level of mandate a requirement that central banks consider broader sustainable development issues across their different technical mandates.
Très vite, s'il vous plaît.
Oui, très vite sur une question qui est beaucoup plus compliquée qu'il n'y paraît.
This is a far more complex issue than what it might seem. I have great empathy for this question, but I need to be cautious. First, it's not the central bank that defines its mandate. To me, it's very important it gets a mandate from democratic debate. So I talked about stability of prices, stability, financial stability. This is not something we invented. I mean, we get a mandate from a political democratic debate. Second caution is that it can be very useful to have this in your mandate, but what's even more pivotal is to carry out actions with professionalism, with objectives, concrete objectives. It's not formally in our mandate, but we do carry out actions that have an impact in all segments of the company.
Better. Merci beaucoup. Merci, Monsieur le Gouverneur. Je vous invite à rejoindre.
Thank you very much indeed, Governor, and thank you for your contribution. So that was very concrete, and this is what we like. Before we listen to Simon, before we listen to testimonies from these beautiful, inspiring people, CEOs from Cameroon, you know, it's wonderful because in 2 years she moved from being an intern to being a CEO of a company, and yesterday afternoon, she was taking part in this debate on companies what for, about female corporate managers. So we'll listen to her now. Adele, hello. Welcome in La Rochelle, the 10th World Forum for Responsible Economy. And the title of our conference this year is Companies, What For? So according to you, what are companies for? Well, companies, they generate goods and services, they create jobs, and they make growth profitable to all employees, and companies to protect the environment by federating future generations. Would you say that challenges ahead of companies? What are these challenges? Well, I think these challenges are really raising awareness, because we need to raise awareness, especially in our continent, in Africa, where the environment is not something that people are fully aware. It's still in an embryonic phase. But I do believe that those challenges, if we just look at the bottom line without taking into account everything around societal responsibility, I think profitability cannot be sustainable. Okay, so last question. Would you say that companies can be part of the solution for the change in the future? Of course they can. Companies must come first, just after governments, because companies are those that have employees, they're those in relationship with their clients, they're those in relationship with their stakeholders and partners, and all type of awareness-raising campaign they can carry out can only be fruitful. Thank you, Adele. Thank you. See you. So, a round of applause, please, to Adele. So thanks for your contribution on the Twitter feed. Everything we heard is been captured on Twitter. And of course, this morning conference is available. You can stream it on our website all throughout the world with all the hubs working with the Alliance Network. And they can send us messages and contribution. So Simon Zadek, I was saying, you are co-manager of UNEP, the United Nations body that looks at environmental issues at regional, national, local level. You work on the evolution of environmental conditions. You look at solutions, and you work on how we can promote the vision of the environment on this planet that would be engaging. And you work with many companies, you support many companies, so we are looking forward to your contribution. You have 10 minutes, and then we'll move with Marie-Claire Capobianco, and then we'll take questions from the audience.
Indeed, and congratulations to the forum. It's a truth, as always, that the Anglo-Saxon community knows far too little about what goes on in France, and so I'm really pleased to be here this morning to learn more. So congratulations again. Let me just ask you, how many of you work in finance? Just put your hands up. Quite a fair number. How many of you feel reasonably confident that you understand how the financial system works? Madame, you have to put your hand up, right? And how many of you feel that finance could be a defining issue when it comes to CSR? Two more. Okay, well, over the next 10 minutes, I'm going to try and increase the number of hands that go up on that first question. It more might also lead to far fewer hands being raised in the first question going forward. So 15 or 20 years on from CSR, really origins in its modern form, what do we know? We know that we've done a lot. We know we form partnerships. We know we produce reports. We know we run programs. We know we do a whole host of things in our global supply chains that we didn't know before. We've done well. I really think we've done well. We also know that the system within which we function, the economy and the broader ecology, has continued to decline precipitously. I won't run through the environmental statistics. I'm sure you can work out your own. But it's clear that CSR has made a difference, but simply not enough to move the system in the right direction. The question is why, and the question is what can one do? Now, of course, you will be the first to agree with me that there's no one simple answer to that. But I want to suggest at least one area that we should look at in more detail, and that is finance. Anyone who works in a company today knows that there is a certain latitude of what is possible to do in the social and environmental space, but that we continue to be exceedingly constrained by financial targets and demands. And those financial targets and demands come down from the heaven, from our most senior executives and board members, but in reality emanate from the financial system itself. This is not a question as to whether we should be responsible to shareholders, but it is a question of whether shareholders are responsible. And perhaps we need to look at that question a little bit more. In the last 20 years, we've stopped talking about new types of solar panels, and we've talked about energy transition. We've stopped talking about new types of cars, and we've talked about a different way of thinking about mobility. We've stopped talking about individual innovations in the agricultural sector, and we have started talking about a different way of thinking about land use. In other words, anyone working in CSR and sustainability has begun to think systemically about change. We no longer only think about individual strands of change.
And there is only arguably one legal sector that has had a free pass, and that has been finance. We have many examples of financial institutions, we'll hear from one today, that have done many interesting things, but the financial system as a whole remains almost untouched by any sustainable development considerations. Even the financial crisis, which by some estimates cost the world $90 trillion, so more than 1 year of global GDP, did not lead to any real discussion about aligning the financial system with long-term sustainable development goals and outcomes. The Paris Agenda agreed on climate, the sustainable development goals agreed in New York last September, all talk about finance, but fail to talk about the financial system itself. The numbers are extraordinary. We need to raise something of the order of $90 trillion between now and 2030 to spend on sustainable infrastructure, energy systems, water, mobility, land use transformation, you name it. If we spend that money on unsustainable infrastructure, then all our efforts on CSR will go for nothing. Nothing, ladies and gentlemen, unless we translate that investment into sustainable investments across many different sectors, we can't hope to meet our climate targets set in this city last December, and we can't hope to manage the complex array of environmental challenges that will cascade into social and economic nightmare. We have to focus on that big picture in order to make our individual CSR and sustainability objectives work. The financial system can no longer have a free pass, and we've heard from the governor of the Bank of France already this morning that change is on the way. At the beginning of 2014, the United Nations Environment Programme launched an international commission of inquiry focused on this question. How does the financial system itself need to change in order to be aligned to what we understand as being essential sustainable development and climate goals and objectives? And I was brought in with others to run that commission. 2 years later, we launched at the IMF World Bank annual meetings, that's in 2015, the results of a 25-country study covering 90 different working papers, working with over 150 different partners, including a number from France, and obviously catalyzed by the process that France was driving towards Paris and also a number of other developments. The results were interesting because far from seeing that nothing was happened, we discovered that actually much is happening, that outside largely of the OECD, away from the major financial centers of London, New York, and elsewhere, we found that many emerging economies, developing countries, central bankers, financial regulators, stock exchanges, and others were busy trying to build social and environmental issues into the rules of the game, not just what individual banks were doing, but the rules of the game governing the way financial markets work. In mid-2014, half a year through our original inquiry, we established a task force with the People's Bank of China that led to a major output at the beginning of 2015 that was then incorporated into China's 13th five-year plan. Their five-year plan for greening the financial sector in China. In October 2015, at the launch of our inquiry report, China announced that they would take this topic to the G20. And during their G20 presidency this year, there has been an active process across every G20 country, including very active participation from the French Treasury and Bank of France, about what kinds of policies and regulations would help progressive banks and other financial institutions from getting it right, and help you as the non-financial community not be so impeded, constrained by the short-termism of much of the financial sector. For you to do your job, the financial sector has to profoundly change. To quote Mark Carney already mentioned by the governor this morning, Mark Carney being the governor of the Bank of England, his language. We need to reset the financial system if it is to serve its purpose in the 21st century. Reset by a governor, not by Greenpeace, not by WWF, not by some activist or community leader, but a governor of a leading bank, central bank in the world, arguing for a reset of the financial system. These are not trivial words and should not be taken trivially. Change is happening. The Sustainable Stock Exchange Initiative, an international alliance of now 40 stock exchanges around the world, are trying to push social and environmental and economic disclosure conditions into listing requirements. The Sustainable Banking Network, a network of 26 banking regulators around the world, all from developing countries, I would note, busy trying to work out what does it mean to be a banking regulator concerned with environmental issues. The UN-backed Principles for Responsible Investment, trillions of dollars worth of assets accumulated under over 1,000 institutional investor members, making commitments about how climate change and broader sustainability issues could be, with help, drawn into the way in which pension funds and insurance companies make investment decisions. This is a very broad agenda, and it is progressing slowly but with increasing momentum. And the role of the Bank of France and also other key central banks, ministries of finance, and also you in advancing this agenda is really important. What you do at a national level really counts. Several things have already been mentioned. Last year, France passed the Energy Transition Law, which amongst other things will require all major financial institutions to disclose climate-related risks on their balance sheets, which has led to a huge upsurge in stress testing and trying to understand how we understand these long-term systemic risks to the assets that actually represent our savings, and in the case of pension funds, our long-term savings and livelihoods. Also, last year, or perhaps starting briefly the year before, there was a presidential commission in France looking at financial markets and sustainable development. It wasn't a huge, sprawling international affair, but actually its results, published halfway through last year, were very useful in the work that's now beginning to emerge internationally. I asked the question of the governor early, what about the FSB, the BIS, the IMF, the G20, and others? This is spaghetti junction of different words and different institutions that most of you, fortunately for you, have never heard of. But those institutions make critical decisions about how the financial system works, and in effect, deliberately or otherwise, make critical decisions about how financial institutions on the ground take sustainability into account. One example, after the financial crisis, the new banking regulation, so-called Basel III, was incorporated by the Bank of International Settlements and has now been rolled out across most countries. In essence, it requires, as many of you know, banks to have higher capital requirements in order to reduce the likelihood of them crashing, as many of them did in 2008. But what about unintended consequences? What about the effect it has on long-term investment? It turns out that both Basel III for banks and Solvency II for insurance companies significantly disincentivizes long-term investments by putting very onerous capital holding requirements on those longer-term illiquid financing operations. And yet, sustainable development requires exactly those investment operations to take place. So those anonymous institutions in the sky that most of you will never heard of and have nothing to do with actually have a pathway of effects that come down to what you can do in your company on a Monday morning. So what does that mean for each group that's represented in the room here today? Because not all of you work on finance, very few of you work in finance, most of you I'm sure, feel that you've got better things to do than focus on finance because it's rather complicated and often rather dry. Well, I think it means something for financial institutions. It means something for those of you working in non-financial institutions. It certainly means something for public institutions. And if there are members of the media and civil society in the room, it certainly means something for you. For financial institutions, through your associations, through your linkages to public institutions like central banks and ministries of finance, you have to advance the importance of these longer-term sustainability aspects in the way in which financial policy, regulation, and standards are being shaped and defined. Ultimately, if the business community and the financial sector doesn't do that, it is inconceivable that central banks and ministries of finance and others will act. And if they don't act, likewise, then those international organizations that you've never heard of will also not be able to move forward. For non-financial institutions in the room, your challenge is to persuade your companies to speak out more forcefully about what kind of financial system you need. We have examples of that. The CEO of Unilever, Paul Polson, has spoken out very strongly as to the limits that are imposed on Unilever and other companies with long-term sustainability goals by the short-term perspectives of much of the financial community. We need other non-financial corporations to speak out on similar issues, to overcome the resistance that your investor relations people have to taking any negative view about problems with investors, and to ensure that there's an alignment between what you say about the financial community and what you say you're trying to achieve in your CSR and sustainability objectives. And for public institutions, it's absolutely clear that unless the rules of the game change in the way in which financial systems work, through the Bank of France and many other organizations in France at a European level and at an international level, unless they are encouraged to act and they act forcefully, financial institutions will continue to constrain what the corporate sector can do on sustainable development. Not because they're mean, not because they're miserable, not because they don't have children, but because the rules of the game force them to demand shorter term returns from you, which obliterates your capacity to think long term on sustainability issues. For civil society organizations in the room, perhaps you are both an opportunity for pushing change, but also the most challenged. The financial sector is a complicated place to work in, much more difficult than many other CSR issues. And much of civil society needs to be up-tooled, trained, educated, in order for them to play a useful role. And for the media, always looking for a scandal to report on, very rarely looking for a good news story to tell their audiences about. Firstly, there is good news. There are changes happening in the financial sector. Secondly, although there are good examples in France, actually the real news is that developing countries and emerging economies, from China to India, from South Africa to Kenya, from Colombia to Brazil and Chile, are the countries that are really pushing the sustainability agenda in the development of financial markets. And that should be news, and if it isn't, it's up to journalists to make it news today. With that, let me bring this opening comments to a close, and I look forward to any questions or comments you may have. Thank you very much.
Come on. Yes. Ah, c'est ça le scoop de la journée, les marchés financiers.
Well, that's our scoop. Good news. Financial markets, good news, financial markets can invent beautiful stories. So we're still talking about finance and CSR. We heard a central bank saying, well, I'm going to take the pulse and see what the CSR impact is on companies and see the outcome in terms of performance. Simon just said that financial market is sort of opening the door. So he's asking us to reset the clock and invent new models. And that's a clear invitation to companies to impose evolutions, if not revolutions, in these financial models. Simon published lots of research and books and articles, one in 2004, which was The History of Future. That was your book. And when we read it again today, you published this book when the World Forum was created, and it's still very much relevant. So, still talking about finance, let's try and see how banks take action. I remind you that in the many contributions that were shared at COP21, the French Federation of Banks was one of the first ones taking the floor and offering solutions. Marie-Pierre Capobianco is sitting on the executive board of BNP Paribas. And amongst your many missions, let me mention just one, that of sitting on the board of directors of ADI. ADI was present everywhere with us in all our debates this week. So when we talk about entrepreneurship, social entrepreneurship, when we talk about social innovation, what can banks do? Over to you for 10 minutes. Welcome. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning, Mr. Chair. First, let me say it's a pleasure for me to be here. And this pleasure is increased tenfold when I hear what I just heard, because I think we are perfectly in line with the reflection and action supported by Philippe Vassin and all his crew. For us, CSR are not just words. CSR is not just finance. CSR is men and women working with our clients everywhere with similar concerns, desires, convictions, and this is what I wanted to share with you. So I'm very happy I'm here with you today, and I'm very happy I joined the movement on this 10th anniversary. I think it was a beautiful opportunity. But I think CSR has changed quite a lot over these last 10 years because we are in a changing world. So this is a world that needs new landmarks. And I think that future generations need and find new balances, and they want to be part of something different. So allow me to speak with two hats on my head. I'll speak as a banker, and I'll speak as a manager, managing teams. And by the way, the relationship you have with clients or the relationship you have with staff is similar in terms of passion. So, talking about what we do, BNP Paribas, we have a very powerful company culture of commitment. Yet in this changing world, we felt we had to change and clarify our mission, clarify on our values, and clarify on how we wanted to do business. So we have a new mission statement. Well, our mission statement is quite simple. As a bank, we need to finance the economy. We need and do that in an ethical way by supporting our clients, help them carry out their projects, enhance the value of their savings, and invest. But we have this economic responsibility, which is very powerful, but we have four responsibilities altogether. We also have another responsibility, which is societal responsibility towards our staff. So we have to be clear when we talk, we have to respect our staff, our employees, and we have to deploy a favorable working environment. We have responsibility towards society, and we do a lot to fight against exclusion. For us, it's very important. We also have environmental responsibility because we are part of this fight against climate change. We're involved. But these four responsibilities, what is important is to try and see how we implement them, how we carry this out. And all this goes through the way we carry out our business in a transparent way, openly observing the highest possible ethical standards. It's also the way we work. We have to encourage initiatives. We have to encourage entrepreneurial spirit. It's also the way we develop our employees, because a team, you know, men and women are the real wealth of a company, the real assets of a company. So all these are values that we have at BNP Paribas. These values are supported by every single staff member. And we need to develop very specific behaviors. We achieve these shared values through consultation with our staff. And all this requires to be sincere and to be genuine. I do have trust in men and in women and in human beings. And I think everything starts with doing things with a sincere and genuine mindset. So this is what we do on a daily basis. When we talk about our French network, we're talking about all our teams working for all our customers in all cities, in all French regions, and they serve all our customers. And in this context, how can we illustrate what we do? Well, I'll just give you very concrete examples to show you what it means. So, what's our job? We support the economy. But in the economy, we can decide and support specific type of companies. And for instance, we have a specific program for innovative entrepreneurship. Why? Because innovation is a driver, is a growth driver, because it leads to transformation. And supporting our clients in transformation is part of our missions, or so we believe. We also have specific focus on social entrepreneurship, because social entrepreneurs are people who want to reconcile economic and general purpose objectives. They want to employ unemployed people who have been unemployed for a very long time, to re-include them in society, but for them to deliver for profit. So by including, and I'm delighted, Banque de France is working on the CSR rating, but we do include, when we work with these social entrepreneurs, we do include the fact that they have a social impact and objective, and we consider this as much as their financial performance. Concretely speaking, we also try and fund social entrepreneurship in a different an innovative way. So we have what we call the social contract, which is the French version of the social impact bond, so that private investors can invest in social innovation with a repayment made by public authorities according to the success of the social enterprise. So we do that through Passport for the Future or through ADI, and we're working on the very first solutions of social impact bonds. That's what we do for social entrepreneurship. Another thing that we do, which is very dear to my heart, is that we support company creation in disenfranchised districts, working close to entrepreneurs in these districts, making it possible for young people from disenfranchised background, working with them, supporting them so that they can set up their company is to me a crucial driver, and it's in line with what we want to do when we talk about supporting underprivileged districts. And Impact Partner, for instance, is one non-profit organization that supports entrepreneurs in these difficult areas. Now, that's all for what we do as a bank. Let me talk about what we do as employees, as a company employing 30,000 people in France.
Apporter également une adaptation, une transformation parce que
there again, there are a lot of expectations from our employees, especially the younger generations. Things have dramatically changed. And as an employer, we need to project, and we want them to be proud of the company they work for and of who we are and what we do. Again, a few initiatives. We've launched the People Lab Initiative. The People Lab Initiatives give employees an opportunity to develop a project 1 week, I'm sorry, 1 day a week during a 6-month period. Doing this gives them a chance to create content, build content around around initiatives they believe in. We've created a tribe, the tribe of the agile people. A lot of people have great talent, talent which is not always used in the company. And we're asking these people to bring out, to share that talent and see, and then we see how we can use the talent. People who know how to draw, for example, we find we have meetings now where we use people who actually draw what is happening, not just write, but draw what is happening. It's great. So these are, this is not finance. We're very far from finance. These are little things we do every day. So by means of conclusions, I would like to say that I'm convinced that in today's world, corporate and social and societal responsibility has become essential. It is a way to get greater employee commitment. It is a way to get employees on board. It's a way to get them invested, personally invested. More and more, we are expected as a bank to deliver solutions that are responsible. And it is a way for us to transform. We live in a world which is going faster and faster and which is becoming completely digital. And placing this at the heart of our work is a sign of progress in a sense. So again, in a nutshell, being concrete and sincere, is and will be a driver for companies that believe in the future, that want to bring hope for the future. Thank you for your attention.
Pour d'ouvrir mon micro, alors je vais peut-être prendre celui-là. Voilà, pardon.
I was looking at the tweet. The tweets we were getting. I think I saw a drawing. I don't know if we can display it on the screen. That would be nice. So let me just briefly summarize. Finance and CSR. Philip, before we continue, we've just heard a lot of things, a lot of proposals. Would you mind reacting, Philip? That was unexpected. Well, off the cuff. I think we've just covered a very large surface. I certainly think that a lot of the things we've heard this morning deserve to be known by the general public. finance is, as Simon suggested, it doesn't always, you know, have a very good reputation. But I think that you've also just demonstrated that things are changing, and finance is an instrument which can contribute to the momentum, to a positive momentum. That's, I think, in summary, how I feel after listening to the different speakers so far. Okay, I think we can take 5 minutes for questions and answers. Jean-Bernard Lévy has just arrived. He will be joining us after. Madam, would you like to start with the first question? You have a mic already. Great. Good morning. My name is Natalie Amy. I'm a consultant in sustainable development and change, as well as an HR consultant. I would like to share my story. Try to keep it short. Yes, you said in a world which is digitalizing, we need to place the people, humans, at the heart of everything we do, and I would really like to support that. Society is changing, but people are changing individually. Society is changing because people individually are changing. I changed, you changed. So it's not a question. I simply wanted to say thank you. Well, we did get interesting contributions. You talked about managerial changes. You said that CSR is a way to manage the company. You insisted on one word, which struck me, being sincere. As an employer, absolutely, absolutely. I do believe that this is essential, and we are a brand, of course, but before being a brand, we are a group of people, we're humans, we're human beings. And we want our employees to feel comfortable, to feel stimulated and motivated in the company and the brand they work for. So again, I insisted on the word sincerity, and you're absolutely right, but I have very strong feelings about this. And that's why we have very strong commitments. It's really about change. It's about transformation. Could we, I think we can take one or two more questions. My name is Frank Sprecher. I'm a national delegate for young business leaders. I work on new business models. We have about 1,000 business leaders who are exploring new business models. And I have two questions for the governor and for you, madam. We're today working on more complex business models. And one of the things we need to finance is knowledge, for example, and trust. When we ask for €1 million to finance trust, people don't understand. What would be your suggestions? Do you have any contacts you could give us? People we could talk to go a bit further, because we'd like to work on financing schemes for these new business models. Once we have a value proposal, a value proposition, we need to go further. We need the banks to come with us hand in hand. And this is something we are struggling with. Again, we're talking about over 1,000 business leaders. Nationwide. I'm always happy to meet with new people. Financing trust is interesting and important, because financing trust means we're not only financing a project, but someone behind the project, which means you need to trust the person behind the project. For trust, to build trust, you need full transparency, perfect understanding, active listening, and I think, of course, there are also criteria to decide yes or no whether you want to finance. But before, you need to really actively listen, understand, and that's how you can create trust. So my answer to your question is yes, I'm more than happy. One question coming from Twitter for Simon, and I believe. What's the first measure? And there is, in order to put things, and
if one's looking particularly at climate, energy systems, air pollution, then clearly fossil fuel investment is a big piece of what needs to change. But there are many different ways to do that. There's clearly a more public divestment campaign type approach. There's the energy transition law type approach of the French government, which forces financial institutions and other corporations to crystallize fossil fuel related risks on their balance sheets. That also makes significant changes. There's the Financial Stability Board internationally that's driving towards a higher level of disclosure about climate risks across the business community. So yes, fossil fuel investment is clearly key, but there are many different mechanisms for doing that. And then I would just make kind of one other kind of connected comment. In each country, priorities are different. If you're sitting in South Africa, then the single most important financial issue is black economic empowerment. It's not fossil fuel investment. And so the financial sector compact that's been made between the South African financial sector, the trade union movement, the government, and the ANC, you know, is all about black economic empowerment. If you're sitting in Bangladesh, then the single most important things are rural financing. And so the central bank in Bangladesh has focused on offering refinancing lines off its balance sheet for banks that are particularly focused on financing the rural economy. So maybe if you're sitting in France at some abstract elite level, or where I am at some abstract elite level, fossil fuel investment is always number one. But actually, at a country by country and community by community level, priorities vary and one needs to respond primarily to where a community is at.
La dernière question, donc elle est pour vous.
The last question is for you. What's my time and my time invested in social SMEs versus key accounts or trading? Well, financing for SMEs is really a majority. Let me tell you a little bit about the financing of the social and solidary economy, because this is also something we do. In France today, we're financing 200 million solidary and social entrepreneurs. This is a figure which is ambitious and it's increasing. We're talking about small amounts, very small amounts, but we are willing to support all those who are willing to socially transform. Okay, sir, madam, thank you very much. We're now moving on to the second halftime of this morning's session. What do companies do? What do companies wish to do? We will have two testimonials, one from Jean-Bernard Levy, who is the CEO of EDF. Sir, would you please join us? We've talked about CSR, financial resilience, territories. You are very much a territorial company. You're today a truly global organization. What is EDF doing? Well, thank you very much. Thank you for giving me a chance to talk about CSR at EDF. Um, It's a real pleasure for me to be able to take a step back and reflect upon these important and interesting subjects going forward. EDF was created 70 years and a few months ago, and historically we've always had socially responsible objectives, and EDF has also a public service mission, which is to supply energy to all the French in a safe and secure way at affordable prices, with efforts made for the underprivileged, the precarious, and we have we're strongly committed to our territories, which manifest itself in different ways. A big event occurred a few years ago, global warming. And global warming has become one of our responsibilities as a company as well. So you've asked me to present what EDF's six objectives, CSR objectives, are. We've actually developed these recently. I've addressed EDF's General Assembly back in May, and we've really fine-tuned these six objectives, and this summer they have become a fully-fledged part of our strategy. As all companies, we are doing our budgeting for next year. We're also preparing our strategic framework and objectives going forward for the company, and as well as for its different entities. And for the first time, our strategic framework will include these six CSR measures. And of course, it hasn't just happened overnight. It's been a long journey. It started last year. We've discussed in a lengthy way with the executive board, as well as with different entities across the group, to set up these six objectives. And we have based some of these objectives on what some of our outside stakeholders have told us. You talked about the law of energy transition. You talked about COP21, and of course we fully support these and want to be an active stakeholder. One way to fight against injustice, poverty, precarity, is to provide an equal access to power, and this is of course something we're still struggling for around the globe for more than 1 billion people. So we've engaged in sustainable objectives, and we are working with partners, with non-for-profit organizations as well. We're working with them to fight against inequalities, climate change, and of course ensure our public service mission for all our customers, no matter where they live. So our objective is to make these six CSR objectives known to the general public. We want them to be followed and monitored by the company's executive board. We want people within the company to own these six objectives. So what are they? What are the six objectives? The first one is to go beyond the 2-degree objective set by COP21. We want to dramatically reduce our CO2 emissions. We are the number one producer of renewable energy across Europe, thanks to our hydraulic production and thanks to some of the investments we have made in both solar and wind energy in France, but also in some of our neighboring countries. And last year, we did a strategic review of our coal assets around the world, including fossil fuel trade. And as a matter of fact, we have made some, we've communicated that we were going to put these activity in a non-controlled joint venture with Japanese partners. As you know, the imports, coal imports are very important in Japan. So we're very closely monitoring our trading activities and trading activities of coal. And we want, as I said, our objective is to go further than 2 degrees. What will we be doing? Well, first of all, we're going to plead in favor of a minimum price for carbon in France. And as the president of the French Republic said in April, there will be a carbon price in Europe before the end of the year, and a corridor price for CO2 in Europe. Another objective is the following. Thanks to our equipments, we have very few CO2 emissions for the actual production because of our nuclear plants and because of our renewable energies. However, this is not the case in transportation and housing. So we are trying to play an active role in these areas in order to contribute more actively, because this is really where things are happening. And we think that by acting on these, transportation again and housing, we can make a difference. And we are working very actively with territories on electric mobility, for example, housing as well. There again, in housing, we know that the housing sector can greatly contribute to reducing greenhouse emissions, but in practice, the current regulations are in favor of gas consumption, which is fossil fuel, versus other fuels, which is not a good thing. And so things have to change. We are also looking at rebalancing our investments in order to decarbonate more and contribute more to decarbonate. We want to beef up our renewable energies. We want them to double by 2030. Last but not least, we are working actively. I'm happy that BNP Paribas is here, but we're working actively also at financing low carbon solutions, energy efficiency solutions, and other solutions. We've been the very first ones to issue green bonds. We have now come to the third issuance of bonds, 1.4 billion in 2013, 1.7 in 2016. The figures are unimportant, and some of these were actually in US dollars, others in euros. The bottom line is that we've issued more than 4 billion worth of green bonds since 2013. So this is what we've done for this very first objective. The second objective is to better integrate industrial activities. And work on areas such as health and safety. When I joined EDF 2 years ago, I very quickly realized that we were not performing well. Our performance, left time injuries have not been good. Our record is not good, and we have decided to change this. We have taken a number of new indicators on board, and things are changing. As you can imagine, this is a long journey. So far, it's been a top-down approach, and it is starting to pay off. Another important objective in human development is diversity. Human diversity, that is men and women. Historically, we are a technology company with a lot of engineers, and therefore a lot of men, coal handling, a lot of outdoor works, construction with Enedis and so on. So we historically, let's face it, we were not very good in terms of diversity. The majority of our employees in the past were men. It's we can't really change things overnight because it's part of our culture. But I think we've engaged in some change, and we are trying to have more women on board, for example, at the executive committee level as well as at a managerial level. The third important objective is social promotion. This is, on the contrary, very much part of our DNA at EDF. EDF is promoting social inclusion, and we have a lot of managers today who when they joined the company were not managers. So the third objective is to offer information and support solutions to the underprivileged, all of them. We have instruments to support those who are struggling to pay their bills. Different measures to help them consume energy in a wiser way. We have advisors around the country. So far, they've already worked on 500,000 requests. We have solidarity workshops in specific neighborhoods where we provide training to employees in order to lower their energy bills. The fourth objective, the clock is ticking here, we are also trying to innovate with digital solutions in order to improve our energy efficiency. The objective is for all customers to consume more wisely. The frontier between technology, energy, and digital is disappearing. Yesterday, we launched SoWe. SoWe is a new solution launched by EDF with a new brand. It combines a connected station, a set of services, online services. It's extremely interactive to supply energy, initially gas, but also power.
Innovation through digital solutions is going to help us meet sustainable development objectives. And what's important is power consumption. But SoWe is also a system that helps us address air quality issues. And we will implement many new digital solutions in this field. Many other digital platforms were launched by EDF. I'd like to mention this free app available to any of you so that our customers can keep a close eye on their energy consumption from their tablet, their smartphone, and know how much they have consumed per type of use. Hot water, warming. This coupled to our new meter, this will help us provide new digital tools to better communicate with our clients and support them in using less energy. And all this is based on a huge energy we have in big data or data analytics, call it the way you want, but all this is based on algorithms that we developed ourselves because we have some math experts at EDF, and thanks to these algorithms, we can provide our consumers with tools to better consume. These tools are free of charge, and we support companies for them to improve their environmental impact, so we provide them with advice. And there are many other topics when you think about lighting, the cold chain, inclusion of renewable energies in companies. There are many topics for which companies really need to be supported. And I'm thinking in the north of France, we are at the forefront of this effort to support companies. Fifth objective is to organize a systematic approach of consultation around new projects, especially when we talk about construction of new projects. There is extremely high social demand when we talk about a major project which is going to have an impact on the ecosystem, on the landscape, on the life of people in a given region. So we've decided to draft a guideline of good practices so that for each of our projects for a value of more than 150 million euros, we will now implement a chart of good practices to be transparent, to listen to populations, to consult with local population, so that we can make sure our projects develop and grow in a smooth and proper way. The sixth objective in terms of sustainable development is to have a positive approach to biodiversity. That's another new thing for an EDF. What Mrs. Royal and Mrs. Pompili presented to Parliament a few months back provides us with a very favorable framework so that we can better assess the environmental sensitivity of natural areas in the vicinity or even within our production areas. And we can think about hydropower, for instance. So the sixth objective is one on which we are going to implement actions to increase biodiversity, and this in close partnership with external stakeholders and in close partnership with other organizations we work with, like the League for the Protection of Birds, the Conservatory of the Coastline, etc., etc. Okay, so that's the end of my presentation, but I think it was useful to tell you about the way we concretely see what our corporate social responsibility is about in our company and with the different programs that we implement. Thank you very much, and I'm available to answer any of your questions. Thank you very much, Mr. CEO. So for these six axes that you described, and of course everyone is expecting you on sustainable development, greenhouse gases emissions, and everything you said about being involved in territories, you were talking about the Northern France region, which is a perfect example of these ecosystems that are put in place to sort of change the world. Philippe Vasseur, did you want a few words? Well, we've launched, when I say we, I mean the entire local community, politicians, economics. And we decided to go for the third industrial revolution, and you're very much involved in that. And we want this region to transition to the 21st century. So this is an experimental approach. We have an a method, and the involvement of EDF since the very beginning has been very powerful and is a key for the success of this operation. And by the way, there is a book available summarizing, it's quite big, but summarizing the approach. Now, I'm very happy about this partnership. No, you know, sometimes people tend to forget to mention that. So I wanted to be clear. Yeah, if somebody can bring a book, we're going to offer a book to Mr. Levy. There it is. There you go, sir. You have the book. So that's a very powerful and pragmatic demonstration of what you do. Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Thank you for your contribution. Mrs. Fréchette, we were sort of waiting for you. We are delighted you're with us today. When I was taking part to the preparation meeting with the entire World Forum team, I could hear them say, we need this woman. Yeah, yeah, this is the way they said it. Absolutely. Because you have such a varied experience of companies, of territories, of countries, especially with this position that you held at the United Nations as Vice General Secretary. And for your country, Canada, you also had many positions as ambassador in Argentina, then in Canada again. You worked in defense at the Treasury. And You sit on many boards, that of Essilor, that already participated in the World Forum with the diversity of their experience. So all this led the whole team to say, well, at a time where we are meeting with companies, where companies are shifting to a more sustainable business model, when companies are beginning to open to all stakeholders, when companies are realizing their social role and responsibility, well, now we need to go one step further and even go to breaking points. So thank you very much, ma'am, for being with us. Well, first for these kind words of introduction, it's always nice to know that people want you. Let me say that I really wanted to be here today because this idea of corporate social responsibility is something which is very dear to my heart. In my job at the United Nations, I've been closely involved in the launching of the Global Compact, and my work at the moment with Essilor provides me with daily examples of the way companies answer to this call for solidarity, often working together with NGOs. And this is what I'd like to talk about this morning, this cooperation between NGOs and corporations, and this more specifically in developing countries. Countries in the South are having an increasingly important role to play in the growth strategies of companies, either as suppliers of raw materials or commodities or consumption goods, or as future or current markets. It's no use talking about the challenges that these regions are faced with, and it's no use spending too much time talking about the needs of their populations. Despite the changes in poverty, more than a billion people still live with less than $1.25 per day, and 2.5 billion live with less than a dollar per day. In those regulated markets where social infrastructure in health and education is very often failing, social responsibility of corporations can't stop to the mere observance of local legislation. Many companies concerned about their social responsibility have adopted ethical rules that they demand are respected by all their representatives, agents, and suppliers. This is the case at Essilor, whose performance in this field is regularly assessed by the CSR committee working with the board that I'm representing. An increasing number of companies also want to contribute more directly to the improvement of living conditions in underprivileged regions, whether through philanthropy or through more ambitious initiatives of social enterprise. The reasons motivating a company to be involved in such initiatives are many, and very often they combine humanitarian and commercial interest. I think we need to be happy about it because the CSR objectives have even more opportunities to become reality if they fit at the core vision, in the core vision of a company. Like Essilor decided that they would do everything they need so that all humans on this planet who need glasses can get glasses. The social objective is obvious. People with poor vision, with just a pair of glasses, can make a better income, be more successful in school. The selling of these glasses at a very low price is also part of the global growth strategy of Essilor, because Essilor gains an understanding of markets that they never explored before and gains a better understanding of future clients. The commitment of corporations in social responsibility is increasingly valued by investors. As we said this morning, far from being seen as marginal, philanthropic activities and social investment, along with good performance in the field of the environment, in the field of fairness in the workplace, in the field of ethical behaviors, have an increasingly big impact on investors' decisions and on the reputation of companies. Doing well by doing good. This old concept attributed to Benjamin Franklin is verified on a daily basis and is a powerful driver for development and innovation in the field of CSR. Doing well, do good business is the core business of the private sector. Doing good is without any doubt that of NGOs. The world of NGOs is as vast as varied. I'd like to talk about the ones I'm most familiar with, those working in international development and humanitarian aid, having a mission to improve the living condition of the most disenfranchised populations. This is the case of CARE. CARE is one of the largest companies of this type in the world. It's a federation of 14 members, including CARE France, and I want to pay tribute to their presence in this room. And they celebrated their 70th anniversary, and they operate in 75 countries. Cooperation between NGOs and corporations is nothing new, but the emergence of this concept of CSR also motivated the emergence of many partnerships that go far beyond donations and endowments, although donations and endowments are always very much welcomed by NGOs. These partnerships have different forms and are exercised at different levels. I would like to note the fact that a large number of companies, especially here in France, are open to a dialogue, to an increasingly deep consultation with civil society in order to better take into account CSR challenges. For instance, here in France, you have companies taking part with civil society representatives, companies like Lafarge, Veolia, EDF, just to mention a few. These panels allow companies to better understand what civil society expects and come up with recommendations based on their experience of good practices and based on the realities experienced by communities where they operate. So a more structured, longer-term dialogue can also be set up between a non-profit organization and a company when trust relationship exists between partners. So since 2011, Air France has a partnership with AXA to support the company in CARE France has a strategic partnership with AXA. Non-profits and companies can also sign alliances to lobby governments and raise awareness with regards to certain social sciences challenges. So an alliance between academia, research center, and non-profit to document the impact of poor vision on economy, health, and education was brought together by Essilor in order to lobby lawmakers and politicians. The impact of actions undertaken by companies very often is achieved through non-profit because of their local routing, which is very important to ensure local impact. Like in Mexico, you have Salud Digna, a non-profit that provides medical checkups to the most underprivileged populations. And they added vision tests to their set of tests. Cooperation with private businesses can also help non-profit organization to improve their own performance. And I'm thinking about Care US. Their emergency team used the logistic know-how of UPS in order to better manage their inventories of emergency equipment and became therefore more efficient. New forms of partnership, more ambitious, more exhaustive partnerships came to light little by little. And these aim at supporting the setting up of businesses generating both income and jobs. Care has had an interest in the economic aspect of development. They had an initiative of microcredit outside the banking system, which was set up more than 25 years ago. A partnership between Care UK, Plan International, another major non-profit, and the Barclays Bank are working to ease access to banking services for disenfranchised people so that they can have access to a whole array of services. Apart from the CFSAR partnership between Galerie Lafayette and Care France, you have the Blue Project in Bangladesh for the production of indigo in small farms in the north of Bangladesh. It led to the creation of a first collection, which was sold at Galerie Lafayette with great success. Care teams in Bangladesh supported this beautiful project, which might lead to the setting up of a profitable, sustainable company. Third example, Care UK, along with GlaxoSmithKline and Barclays Bank, they're working on setting up a social company to improve the distribution of basic healthcare products in communities which are not served by traditional commercial networks. 250 women were trained so far, and their income has already increased quite dramatically thanks to this work. Essilor also adopted a similar approach in India through the Haimitra program, with small entrepreneurs being trained through non-profit Indian organization. Haimitra serves districts which have no optometrists, and they train people with the support of Essilor in the field. The implementation of partnerships between non-profit organizations and companies is not always easy, especially when you're dealing with ambitious projects requiring long-term commitment from both partners. Private sector culture is not similar to that of non-profit organizations, and very often there was a lot of defiance in both camps. There is no one-size-fits-all type of solution for partnership to succeed, but some ingredients seem crucial. First, time and patience, so that partners can understand and get to know one another. Trust and confidence needs to be present for a true partnership to develop. Second, commitment and support from CEOs and managers. If they're not convinced, there is a high risk that their teams won't dedicate the required energy. Thirdly, the respect of each partner's competencies. NGOs and companies have strengths and weaknesses that need to be recognized right from the start. Finally, clarity in setting the objectives, being rigorous in assessing implementation, and having the guts to terminate a project or correct the objectives when the expected results are not met. What NGOs are looking for with their business partners is a genuine desire, what Mrs. Capobianco was calling sincerity. So a genuine desire to fight against poverty and to protect the environment. NGOs want to be certain that the business has another motivation than just having a bit of greenwashing and looking good in terms of CSR. Likewise, companies don't want to be treated as milking cows by NGOs who are always looking for funding. But when partners share a similar vision, and when they both have at heart the well-being of those they want to support, then together they can achieve results that would be outside their reach if they were to act individually. That's the ambition of the partnerships I just described, and which I want to see growing and multiplying in the interest of millions of disenfranchised people throughout the world. Thank you very much for your attention. Okay. Stay with us for a few minutes. This was your advocacy in favor of action and interactions between NGOs and businesses, getting to know each other, recognizing each other, leadership from the managers, respecting each partner's competencies and expertise with a genuine desire. Okay, so let's take a couple of minutes. Do we have NGO representatives? So we have CARE. Maybe you can say a few words, and there was someone here at the back who was willing to say a few words. Yes, please, sir. I'm not going to read my notes, but I have a lot to say. I'm bouncing back on what was said by Mr. Governor this morning, when he said, when the core business of the company is not compatible with a CSR approach, and when you said, we need to be able and stop a project when it doesn't deliver. So my question, there are companies whose core business is not compatible with a long-term CSR company. I'm thinking about polluting companies or tobacco makers. If I'm the CEO of a company that makes a lot of profit in one of these industries, what can I do? And shouldn't we, with the forum, establish a list of those companies that go against because they jeopardize the health of millions of people? The blacklist of the World Forum, so to speak. You need to answer this question, but first your comment. Well, I can't speak on behalf of the World Forum as to the best way, but what I know is that there is a large number of major investors, pension funds and other major investors, who already have these kind of blacklists, and they won't invest in tobacco companies or other companies seen as unacceptable given their own objectives and their own values. And by the way, NGOs also score these companies, and they have ratings in order to define what kind of companies they want to work with and what kind of companies they don't want to work with. However, I think that even those companies working in fields which are deemed not very useful for the progress of society at large, they also have obligations in terms of social responsibility. So long as tobacco companies are in business, I do hope that in the way they manage their teams on a daily basis, I do hope that they adopt the best practices. And when we talk about polluting companies, well, I think we're talking about society at large, and we need to talk about the role of each individual stakeholder, starting with governments, with shareholders, with voters, etc., etc. Okay, Philip, thank you. That's a very old debate, not very original, to be honest. I looked at socially responsible investment, and we had many debates, like what kind of scoring do we use? Do we just use the best in class, or do we eliminate entire industries? If you take just the best in class, you can take weapon makers, as long as they're not the worst. But this is not a perfect world. We all know that. We want to move forward. So for those companies joining us, sometimes they're at the very bottom of the ladder, but welcome to the club. We don't demand that people are perfect right from the beginning. We can accept such and such company that has carried out such and such action, which is not fine. They polluted. Okay, we agree on that. It's not good. But if at the same time they have initiated an approach, we have to accept that. We are moving forward. We don't want to exclude people. We want to convince the largest possible number of people to get on board. So we start with something small, and little by little, we will become more virtuous or more responsible in our economic approach. Let's think about Umicore last year. Yeah, Umicore. Umicore is one of the worst companies in the world. They had, you know, they were operating mines in the Congo. So they were polluting, they were destroying biodiversity, they were exploiting staff in Africa. I mean, slavery would have been a real progress for their employees. And one day they realized, no, we need to change. And they initiated this approach so as to change everything. Well, congratulations. You know, sinners need to be embraced. Okay, this is talking about redemption now. That's great. Madam.
Thank you. My name is Philippe Lévesque. I'm the head of Care France. And I think we're quite lucid about the way we look at the corporate world. And our chairwoman just said it's important to be sincere. We have partnerships, but not with anyone. We have to manage our donors, first of all, with the public opinion as well. And and of course, the future of populations we're trying to support. The role of an NGO is not to support companies become more virtuous. Our primary goal is to be, you know, to be out there serving communities. There are practices we don't like about junk food, energy practices, and certain products that are not sustainable. If the tobacco industry makes progress, fine, that's good for its employees and for the environment. But we will never accept money coming from the tobacco industry. There is also a very strong cultural dimension. You know, it's easier for us to start a dialogue with European organizations, or at least Western European, Japanese, North American organizations. The real challenge for NGOs today is to enter into a dialogue with Indonesian, Indian, Chinese, and Russian companies. That is much more challenging because there is no real public opinion there. And when there is one, they can't really mobilize. And this is a really big challenge. Well, thank you, sir. Anyone else? Madam? Good morning. My name is Corinne Molina. I represent a group which got an award from the World Forum. We could be on the list of the blacklisted. We are a company that manufactures paint. Paint is not neutral for the environment. What I would like to say is that what really counts at the end of the day is all the work that is accomplished, is the journey. My experience is that you can make things meaningful for employees. We live in a world where not only money counts. People need meaning as well. Employees don't just want money. They want things to, they want meaning. Last week I was working on, I was at a meeting on foreign trade, and we had great talks on the environment, which shows that things are changing at all levels. And as I was listening to Axel Kahn, one of my thoughts was that if France, for the social interest and for jobs, wouldn't it
make sense to really work more on the environment protection in France. In countries like China, where they're less advanced, for example, compared to China, I think that we could really make a difference. I think we should even think about a label, an environmental protection label, to make France different from the others. Okay, well, thank you very much, everyone. Thank you, Madame Fréchette, for your contributions. And thank you for your call to reinforce connections between the corporate world and NGOs. So we are now reaching the end. We're going to have a final summary of this long and busy week. 1 week when we were preparing for the event, Philippe Vasseur arrived with a book. It was your book, Confucius and Les Automates, which was published in 2014. In the book, there is a map, a very unexpected and unusual map of the world and how the world is changing. It's a map which includes CSR and all CSR shareholders in order to make our planet a better planet. Charles Eboué is with a German company. Charles-Edouard Bouy has always worked in Asia, and I think that this is where he found most of his inspiration for this book. And Philip said, I'm going to contact Charles-Edouard Bouy to ask him if he could do a similar mapping of all the World Forum contributions. So this map, which he drew up back in 2014, has been updated. He has accepted to update it. It's a great summary of everything we've accomplished. So Charles-Edouard Bouy, welcome to you. Well, thank you. This was a great introduction. I'm very happy to be here with you all this morning. I think the forum has become a leading institution nationally and internationally. I would like to thank the organizers, Philippe Vasseur namely, for having me with you this morning. So when I was asked to work on the final conclusion, I, of course, wanted to do this with a map. And one of the things that guided me in doing this is how could we better own our future? When we think about corporate social responsibility, when we think about the future, I think one of the things we have to wonder is how we can gain better control of the future and better control of our destiny and the world we're living in. The 2014 map was a map of the new world in 2030, including all the big changes the world was going through. My objective was to try and understand where we were heading. So here it is. Maybe I should take a roving mic. So this map shows a compass, and as you can see, we have a free world in the south, and we have this potential opposition between a world of people, of humans, and on one side, and and machines on the other side. So in the 2060 map in the north, northeast, we have automates, robots, computer servers. They run all the data, the world's data. Then we have operators. Operators, they are the ones who run the machines. They generate a lot of value. We're seeing some of these big ones emerging. Then, and this is something we talked about during the forum, we have the question of energy, energy producers in order to run machines, automates, cars, we need a lot of energy. 15% of global energy consumption is used by servers and machines, equipment we use every day. The fourth is Internet of Things, IoT. All these sensors, cameras, connected machines, devices we have at home, in our offices, and in our cars that connect us to internet. And then we have the sanctuary of the wise. And this is really where the question starts. How do we control our future? Then we have the quaternary world, with different ways of working. And the seventh continent. This is a world where large companies operate. They operate all the data. They own the data, and they manage the data. So this is 2030, and this is today. When I looked at the different topics of the forum, it's very much in line with what I just said. So the question is, we have the 2030 map. Where do we stand today? Look at this continent, right there in the middle. That's today's world, and it is threatened. We all talk about digital transformation. The reality is that if you look at the 2030 map, what we're really going through is a phase of erosion. We're seeing a huge migration towards technology, new employments, new jobs. And the big question is, how do we manage this erosion of today's world? Let's zoom in. This is us. This is where we are. What do we see? We see different things. Companies, corporations, networks, CSR, climate, energy. How do companies prepare their future in that environment? Institutions, think tanks, states. There again, how need their roles and functions be redefined? Well-being at work. The workplace is changing. Self-employed people, startup companies, less actually employed people with a working contract. And no worries, you will get a copy of the map. Here is another zoom. This is the world of great migrations. When you look at what's happening today with an Uberized, increasingly Uberized world, I was fortunate enough to have worked in different countries, France, England, the UK, China, Germany, and I've met so many young people who make startups, and they make startups until they make one that is successful. They don't want to work for huge corporations. They're entrepreneurs. They're self-employed. There are a lot of self-employed people. We're seeing the job market being Uberized, increasingly Uberized, and again, erosion, where people are migrating to this quaternary world, which I described just a few minutes ago. Now, the big challenge for the corporate world, once again, is how do we control this future? There are different territorial mechanisms. Again, we're living in a world of erosion. How do you migrate up north? How do you create a future for your company? In terms of artificial intelligence, robotics, computers. In the 2030 world, we're also seeing people who are migrating up north. They end up in four places, either the seventh continent, the Microsofts, the GAFA, the operators. Some move to highly qualified skills robots, the future industry, the industry of the future. And then there is this small path which is takes you to this rock, which is the rock of the super wealthy multi-billionaires. They have combined data and capitalism, and they are now living on this the rock of the rich, the super rich. So this northward migration is only for a few, a happy few, the elite. There is another group, however, which is moving to this to the quaternary plains. Interesting questions there too. Universal income, social, societal questions, the role of humans in a new society with more free time, where machines have replaced humans. What will be the role of institutions, of governments in that new world? And in conclusion, I would like to say this. I was in at a forum at Silicon Valley, and there was this quote of Senec. Destiny takes those who accept and drags those who don't. This what's ahead of us is unavoidable. We have to accept technologies, and it's better to accept than to drag. There is another quote, which is, there are no favorable winds if you don't know where you're going. And this is really the conclusion of my talk. We need consultants, we need people who can map the future. We need events like this one to better understand where we're going. We need to, you know, put our gray matter together to understand where the world is headed, where companies, authorities, states are going. We need to raise awareness about this erosion. It's not just a problem for one company or for one country or for one industry. It's everyone's problem. Thank you.
Alors, on en fait quoi, ça?
So what do we now do with this, Philip? Well, first of all, I would like to thank Charles-Édouard for having accepted. I think this is very disturbing. We can feel that some of these things are looming. And looking at this journey starting now, between now and 2030, is a bit of pressing. I think we are at a turning point. The world is dramatically changing. This is phenomenal. When I have a little bit of free time, I like to read quotes of big thinkers and experts, and who were always wrong because they refused to admit that the future would be different. Some big thinkers refused planes, aircraft, cinema, TVs. They thought they were gadgets. They think they would, and they ended up changing the world. Well, here's another one. I think for the next 10 years, we have a pretty good idea of what's going to happen. So Charles-Édouard accepted to share this map. And this is, of course, not a conclusion. It's a springboard. This is our 10th anniversary. It's the end of a cycle. Let's start a new cycle. A new cycle based on all the things we've learned, based on all the progress we've accomplished. And with you, all together, hand in hand, we would like to continue working on defining, understanding the world that is ahead of us. Thank you. Well, thank you indeed. Thank you indeed. And please stay here. In a moment, you will be giving the final conclusion. Here is the map. Here is a copy of the map. But use it wisely. Don't just keep it for yourselves. It, once again, this is an updated map. It is directly inspired by the World Forum. I think this is it. This is our roadmap. It shows what mountains have to be, what hurdles have to be overcome. And I think, Charles-Édouard, you have a new book in the pipeline, correct? Yes, it will be out in March or April 17 on artificial intelligence. In the 2014 study, I quickly realized that this was essential. I've been traveling to the US, China, even in France, and it is a burning topic. And again, it's going to change the world. Right. We had a talk on artificial intelligence. We had a lawyer who came in to talk about the rights of robots. Very impressive. As a matter of fact, your books are available for you on your way out for sale. Thank you again for your active contributions. Philip, over to you now for the final conclusion. Well, I think we've pretty much concluded already when I gave my feedback on Charles-Édouard's talk. What I would like to say once again is that there is a lot of change ahead of us, and there is only so much we control, we can master. And sometimes there will be maybe not conflicts, but misunderstandings, tensions between NGOs and corporate organizations. And a forum like this is an opportunity for everyone to share, everyone, and to talk about everything. We've talked about universal income. Some people had very brutal reactions. And when you're a business leader and you're struggling to recruit people, it's a fact, it's a reality. I can understand. I see where you're coming from when they say, how can you pay people to do nothing? And that's not what this is about. It's not about paying people to do nothing. There are people who are getting paid today to do nothing. It exists in, you know, systems we know very well. Some people are you know, adepts of this. I think we should not be afraid to raise all questions. We should raise all questions to come up with the right answers about, you know, a better world, a future world, and hopefully have a less worrying map than the one shared earlier by Charles-Édouard. That's what we are about. This is what we intend to do. I decided 10 years ago it would be a 10-year journey, and here we are at the end of it, and I'm happy and eager to start a new one, and hopefully we can always think a little bit ahead of the others, and let's continue our work all together.